Good morning. I'll try it one more time. Good morning. Thank you. Look around the room. What a great turnout. Thank you for being here on a rainy, sometimes traffic difficult morning. And it's such an honor and a thrill that you've chosen to spend your time with us here this morning at the FIU Center for Leadership Lecture Series. And there's many of you. We have students, we have staff, we have faculty, we have many people from off campus. Just by a quick show of hands, how many of you came from off campus today? Wow, that's fantastic, fantastic. Thank you for visiting FIU. My name is Nathan Hiller, and I'm the academic director at the FIU Center for Leadership. The leadership lectures were established in 2011, and to date have brought more than 36 distinguished and world-renowned speakers to FIU. Today is no exception. I would like to take a minute to thank our longtime sponsors, Amerant Bank, for their involvement and engagement with us over these years in sponsoring this lectureship series. Thank you. Really, thank you for your support. I would also like to thank the FIU Honors College for their continued support of the leadership lectures and all of the honors students with us here today. How many of you are honors students in the Honors College today? Wow, awesome. Welcome. And if I haven't asked you to raise your hand, it doesn't mean we don't love you. Thank you for being here. It is now my privilege to introduce the fifth president of Florida International University, Mark B. Rosenberg.
Good morning, everybody. So really, it's not raining. The sun is always shining on our FIU. And you're part of that sunshine. You're part of that brightness. You're part of the light. You're part of a very, very consequential and significant future we have here in our South Florida. So thank you for being here. I want to thank the board of the Center for Leadership for all the time and effort they've put in. I want to thank Amerant Bank for their efforts, their support. We can't go to the next level as an institution of higher education unless we have the community supporting us, pushing us, pulling us, tugging us, reminding us, and Amerant is providing great leadership for us with our Center for Leadership. And for those of you who aren't sure, this Center for Leadership, they not only talk it, they walk it. They're one of the leading centers for leadership in the United States. And so that's something that you work hard for and you work hard to maintain. And it's conversations like we're going to have today that help us to keep on the high plane that Nathan and his team have set. So Nathan, thanks to you and your staff. I also want to welcome the Medina family. I want to thank Mrs. Medina. I want to thank Tony for being here. I want to thank Melissa. Truth is that we've had an unbelievable relationship with the Medina family for years. Manny Medina has been a leader in our community, an individual who has a vision, an individual who figures out how to turn that vision into the reality. Many ways, just like us. We're pretty good at turning the impossible and the inevitable. If there's anybody who's been able to do that over the years, it's Manny Medina. And fortunate for us that his daughter Melissa has picked up and is now leading the way in so many different dimensions of what we do. So I want to thank Melissa for being here. I want to thank her for taking time to share some thoughts with us. She's a native Miamian. She's now president of Emerge Americas, which is a premier technology gathering that connects a lot of dots between entrepreneurs, talent, capital, people who are in the academic space, creatives, individuals who are very much going to be a part of driving change, driving innovation, driving progress for our 21st century. And if there's one thing we know about our community our community that is still very much embedded in what's coming. Our community is still very much about the future. Our community is still very much about becoming. And the organization that has perhaps best captured that over the last couple of years is the organization that Melissa Medina heads called Emerge Americas. Today, Emerge brings together about 16,000 creatives, investors, entrepreneurs, technologists, business executives in an annual gathering that is a must for those of us who want to not just be with it, but be ahead of things that are coming in this century. Melissa's also put a stake in the ground as it relates to women. She assisted with the launch of the Women Innovation and Technology Summit, brings together top female professionals to showcase their work in transforming industries that are connected to tech and connected to innovation. She's also president of the Medina Family Foundation. And if there's an institution that has benefited more from the Medina Family Foundation than RFIU, and if there's a group of people that have benefited more from the generosity and the thoughtfulness of the Medina Family Foundation than FIU, I'd be hard-pressed to tell you which it is, because we have been the subject of a lot of thoughtfulness and a lot of support so that we can get to the next level, so that when our students, when you graduate, you're right at the cutting edge. That's in part because of the thoughtfulness of the foundation. Now, the foundation has also supported the Nicholas Children's Hospital, it supported the United Way, Women of Tomorrow, Camila's House, and others, offering hope to those who most need it. So here's an instance of leadership where a group of individuals, a family, has not just done well, they've done good. And for those of you who are looking for brightness out there, for pathways out there, for thoughtfulness out there, you need look no further than Melissa Medina and all that she's able to do and all that she represents. So Melissa, it's great to have you here today. Your work inspires us. Now more than ever, we need not just to think about leadership, but we need to figure out how to do leadership even better. And there's no doubt in my mind that the conversation we're gonna have this morning is gonna help us to accomplish just that. So please join me in welcoming Melissa Medina.
Thank you so much. Okay, testing, we're on. First and foremost, thank you, President Rosenberg, for that extremely, extremely kind intro of not only me, but of my family. And more importantly, I really want to thank you and the entire FIU team, Danya, Sandy Gonzalez-Levy, Nathan, for supporting all of our efforts, specifically Emerge Americas, from when it was just a concept, from when it was just an idea. And that truly means a lot to me and to my family. And thank you for this incredible invite today to be part of this amazing leadership lecture series. I am truly humbled and honored to be here with you today. So bear with me for a second, but by any chance, did anyone here attend Tony Robbins' Unleash the Power Within Me last week? Nobody. Yeah, these two up here. Okay, well, I did, and got a little inspired from a few days of inspirational messages from him. So we're gonna do something to kind of get our blood flowing and energy going. So I want everybody in a second to stand up, look at the people around you, high five them, hug them, and if you don't know them, introduce yourself. Go. Let's go. Woo! We'll be right back. So if there was a major takeaway from me attending the Unleash the Power Within Me event, was that him almost forcing us to do this so many times actually did build up my energy, and I had so many more conversations with people that maybe otherwise I wouldn't have. So thanks for participating in this activity. So I was invited today to talk about my personal journey and leadership. Oops. But my journey and my story would be very different if it wasn't for the people that you see on these slides. My mother is the little one there with the short hair. She's sitting here today. My grandmother from both sides, and my father is the one in the middle. So they were all born in Cuba. And I know that many of us have this story, potentially, especially living here in Miami. But their story really affected me and impacted me. My mother came to Miami, landed in Miami at the age of 5 or 6 years old, came on a plane, came with her entire family, and left everything behind. My father was 13 years old when he had to get in a boat with his sister and his parents in the middle of the night and leave everything behind and come and land in the land of opportunity. Thank God they landed in the United States of America, and thank God they landed here in Miami. Now, I had a very different childhood than they had. I was born and raised here in Miami. My brother and I grew up on Miami Beach. We lived an amazing childhood. I had incredible opportunities. I went to amazing schools, had amazing vacations and experiences. However, I never forgot where my parents came from, never. And they never let me forget where they came from either. Told me the stories over and over. My grandparents told me the stories over and over. My grandmother was a hotel maid when she came to Miami. My grandfather drove taxis for years and years and years. My other grandmother, my mom's mom, had to learn a whole new career here. She didn't work in Cuba. Here she got a degree. She became an incredible accountant. I learned the meaning of hard work, and I learned the meaning of gratitude. Always being thankful for the opportunities that I was given. My parents instilled in me that first came family and second is education. Take advantage of being born in this wonderful country. Take advantage of all these wonderful institutions that you have to learn from and absorb from. Those were my two duties in life. Protect your family, family first, and study hard. That was my job, to do well in school. Now, in my teenage years, I studied at the University of Florida. Sorry, President Rosenberg. I wanted to get away from my family for a little bit, okay? And I did my undergraduate degree and graduate degree at UF. Although my master's degree in international business, I actually studied at ESADE, one of the top global business management schools, but it was through a program in UF. And I had a master plan in my late teenage years. And what's the famous saying about plans? You make a plan and God laughs. Well, that certainly happened to me. You see, my father, when I was a year old in 1980, started a company called Terramark. Terramark was a real estate development company. I loved going to his office. I'm talking from a very young age. Sat in meetings with him. I loved due diligence periods. I loved going to site visits and imagining what the building was going to look like. I loved seeing an old building and figuring out how we were going to renovate it. And I just immersed myself in everything that was real estate from a young age. So my plan was, I was going to go to school, I was going to continue to kick butt in school, and my major was real estate and urban analysis. And then, in 1999, so in the middle of my college years, first let me say something. People might think that this was an easy way out for me. My master plan was to take over the family business. But I have to tell you that it really wasn't. Nobody was forcing me to work with my father. He didn't brainwash me to say, you're going to graduate from college and come work with me. I really thoroughly enjoyed the real estate industry. And just to kind of prove my point a little bit more, my older brother, is a musician, and my parents always encouraged us to follow our passion, whatever it was. My brother picked up a guitar at the age of 5 years old and never looked back. He went to Vanderbilt, graduated top of his class, and he's still living in Nashville. He's a bassist in a very prominent country band. And that is because my parents told us, follow your dreams, follow your passion. So I say that my master plan wasn't the easy way out. I just thought it was an incredible master plan. Anyhow, in the late 90s, my father got a tremendous opportunity. And it wasn't real estate, but it was building what you see here. It's called the NAP of the Americas, Network Access Point. Think of it as an exchange point. Think of it as an airport. This was going to be one of five of this caliber NAP of the Americas that was going to be built right here in Miami to basically house all the traffic from Latin America. He won that bid to build it because of his experience in real estate. But what happened was he immersed himself in this IT infrastructure business. He was fascinated by it. And by the time the year 2000 came around, he said, I don't want to only own it, I want to operate it. And I want to sell all of my real estate. So here I am, senior in college, and I'm getting phone calls from his partners, knowing I've interned every summer there. They knew we were close. And they tell me, your father's going nuts. He's going crazy. He's selling all of his real estate. And he's throwing, he's going all in to this technology business. And I think he's crazy, and you need to help me talk to him. And there were two things going through my mind. One was, I was ecstatic for him. I knew he was a visionary. I believed in him. I knew that if he was selling all of the real estate company, he was doing it for a reason. He saw something that a lot of people didn't see. Of course, inside, I was also upset because I'm like, oh, there goes my master plan. There goes my dream of owning, and running our family real estate business. But hey, sometimes in life you have to pivot, right? And sometimes those things that are thrown in your path are thrown in your path for a reason. Anyhow, I finished with my master's degree. At that point, the NAP was built in 2001. I graduated in 2002 with my master's, and he was doing great. The company had its ups and downs, just as the real estate company had as well. So when I graduated with my master's, I said, everything I know is real estate. I even majored in real estate and finance as well. So I went and I worked for Surveyor Real Estate. I worked for Sotheby's. I worked for a company called Greater Miami Investments. And I was doing really well. This was in the real estate boom. I was a young girl in my 20s selling commercial properties, which was, at the time, there wasn't many females selling commercial real estate. But all the while, I was still immersing myself in what my father was building. My issue was that I was scared. I didn't know enough about technology. I didn't know enough about IT infrastructure and cloud computing. But I started immersing myself in it. And there was something in me that really valued that bond and that relationship professionally and personally working with my father. So I said, you know what? I do want to work at Terramark. I don't want to be given anything, but I want to work there. I want to work there in a capacity that makes sense for the qualities that I had at the time. So I started as a financial analyst in a junior role and worked my way up. In 2011, something really big happened. Just stay here. Something really big happened for the community, for our family, for our ecosystem. And that was that Terramark, think about this, Terramark, founded as a real estate company by a Cuban immigrant who came here at 13 years old and had a rough high school years, completely converted to a technology company in the late 90s, early 2000, no more real estate at all. In 2011, Verizon came knocking on Terramark's door. Verizon, global enterprise, 800-pound gorilla of a company, wanted to buy Terramark. So it took a while, but eventually the transaction happened. Verizon purchased Terramark worldwide in 2011. This was a great success story, not only for a Cuban immigrant, there's many of those stories, absolutely, in our community, but for our ecosystem. Miami was never really known as a tech hub. But here was this huge company purchasing Terramark. It was a great success story. But my father and I were out of jobs. So we had a conversation, and the conversation went something like this. Melissa, we have faced a lot of frustrations building a technology company in Miami. It was difficult at times to recruit talent. It was also difficult when we left Miami and we attended these amazing global conferences all over the world. People would ask us, why is your company headquartered in Miami? You are a technology company. So he said, I want to change that. I want to change that for future technology companies. I don't want other technology companies to go through the frustrations that we went through. So he basically posed a challenge. What can we do together to change the future landscape of our tech ecosystem? And how can we continue to give back to a community that has been so good to us and to our family? So in 2012, we established the Technology Foundation of the Americas with one sole purpose, and it was to spark the tech ecosystem in Miami. And I started then learning a little bit more about the history of tech in Florida. And I'm not going to go through all of this, but did you know that in 1973, the first mobile call was made right here in Plantation, Florida? In 1981, the first PC, the first personal computer, was designed by IBM here in Boca. All of this started giving me all these ideas, and it also made me realize that we do have all the ingredients here in this ecosystem. It was more about telling the story, connecting the dots, more success stories. So we decided we're going to create a convening of our own. We're going to bring together entrepreneurs, investors, global enterprises, universities, government officials, and we're going to begin changing mindsets of folks. This could be an incredibly thriving tech and entrepreneurial ecosystem. And we were going to go all in on this together. This was, for me, in my story and in my journey, the true beginning of my entrepreneurial journey. I knew I had a vested interest in this. I was very passionate about it, and I really wanted to help build this from the ground up. So in 2014, 2 years after establishing the Technology Foundation of the Americas, our first project launched. It was Emerge Americas, Global Technology Conference. We had no idea if this was going to be successful or not. No idea. But we believed in it, and we were going to do everything we could to make sure, at least try to make sure, that it was successful. Emerge 2019 wrapped up this spring, and if you didn't attend, please watch this video. It'll give you a glimpse into what Emerge Americas is all about.
Thank you. Emerge Americas is really important because it shines a spotlight on the tech community. It gives us a focal point. It brings everybody together, gives us an opportunity to connect. So it gives us not only that local connection, but also gives us that national stage for us to be able to showcase that, you know, attract outside talent, attract outside resources, and, you know, continue to grow the ecosystem that we're all proud of.
Thanks. So now, Emerge America's launch, 2014, opened the doors, and we had over 5,000 people at our first event. We realized, I think we were onto something bigger than we even anticipated. We had, I think, tapped a niche in the market, which is the connection to Latin America. Miami has been the gateway to Latin America for so many other industries, but never really had been for tech and entrepreneurship. And we decided this is going to be much more than just an event. Yes, we're going to continue to build this annual technology conference, but this is going to be a platform. There's going to be a network. We're going to connect all the stakeholders you see there, not only at the event, but throughout the year. We're going to connect the universities, entrepreneurs, investors, global enterprises, government officials, and we're going to have those conversations about technology that's transforming our lives and transforming industries. And little by little, we're going to change mindsets. And we're going to build and foster a thriving and sustainable tech hub right here in South Florida, which so many people had told us couldn't happen, both when I worked at Terramark and both when we were evangelizing this concept. So many people push back. There's no way that's going to be successful here. You don't have enough demand. You're all crazy. But thankfully, support from President Rosenberg and FIU, Miami-Dade County, there were a few that saw what we saw and that believed in us. And I'm happy to say that according to the Washington Economics Group, Emerge Americas now in almost 7 years has had a $1.4 billion impact on our state. $1.4 billion coming out of this small idea that we had back in 2012. And we've helped create over 7,000 jobs to this day. This year's conference, we had over 16,000 people from over 40 different countries. And something even more exciting happened. We launched, together with FIU, the Emerge Insights Reports. So now we're not only telling the story and connecting all the players, but we're tracking the data now. So the Insights Report is a collaborative effort where we are reporting on all the venture activity that happens in our state. Nobody else is doing this. But it also helps us prove our story. 2018, our first report, the entire year of 2018, there was $1.3 billion in venture activity in our state. The 2019, 6 months, we're doing it biannually now, 6 month report that just came out, $1.5 billion in venture activity in our state. That means that in 6 months of 2019, we've outpaced the entire year of 2019. Now I want to talk to you about stereotypes and labels and shattering those. Because that girl you see right there, that young lady, or young adult, is me, and she's also a Latina. Oops, my heel just got stuck, okay. She's a Latina, a proud Latina at that, but only 1%, some people say even less, of women make up senior executive roles in the technology industry. Less than 1%. And I want to change the face of that industry. I'm also a female in a very male-dominated industry. Nothing against the males in this picture. My father's in this picture. My business partner, Felice's, in this picture. But it's just to prove a point here. I'm always surrounded by males. I could tell you countless stories of getting to meetings and people asking me where my boss is. Or getting to meetings with partners in Latin America and being given a coffee order. It happens. But if I let all of those experiences weigh me down, where does that get me? Who really loses in those instances? I'm also the founder and head honcho's daughter. You might think, oh, that's not really, you know, a label or a stereotype, but it is. Although if you ask him, he'd say I'm his boss, I think. But it is, because throughout my career, I know it, I hear it. Oh, she was given that job. She didn't really deserve it. You have to prove yourself a little more. You have eyes on you all the time, see if you make a mistake. And you have to build trust. Because other employees say, oh, she's gonna go tell her dad. Oh, if I come in late, she's gonna go tell on me. So it is a stereotype, and it is a label that I had to work through. It's not something that I struggle with so much today. My father runs an incredible cybersecurity company, and I'm at Emerge. But it is something that I've struggled with earlier on in my career. I'm also a wife to an incredible husband. I must say that, he's right here. No, but in all honesty, he is definitely my much better half. A wife can't lead a technology company. She's also a mom of 5 children. I'll leave that one there. There's a whole lot of implications that go in that. But if I listened and really looked at all the statistics of being a Latina, a mom, a wife, a mom of 5, the boss's daughter, I wouldn't be here today giving you this talk. I wouldn't have, a couple of months ago, it blew my mind. I was listed as South Florida's power tech leaders. What? That's insane. Nobody with those labels can do that. So today I'm here just to share a few lessons I've learned. I've made a ton of mistakes, made wrong decisions, but here are some of the takeaways, or I don't know, words of wisdom, if you will. Forget about the stereotypes and the labels. Don't put yourself in a box. Don't limit yourself by what other people say you should or shouldn't be doing. Take full advantage of the opportunities that are in front of you. Right here, how many of you are students in FIU? Amazing. FIU is an incredible institution. Are you building a business? Do you know that FIU has Startup FIU? Are you in a cybersecurity, or do you have a cybersecurity idea? Do you know they have an incredible cybersecurity lab and initiatives? Take ownership of the opportunities you have. Find out about them, explore, open your mind. And if I could pick out one of these, I would definitely say passion is key. Make sure you're passionate about what you're doing, personally and professionally. Because there's gonna be days where you hit the floor. There's gonna be days like we had evangelizing Emerge as a concept that people said, that will never work, just stop right now, don't do it. But if we didn't have the passion to build what we were building, we probably would have stopped. We would have closed the doors and said, you know what, forget it. Let's just move on and do something else. Don't be afraid to take smart risks. And I say smart because don't be stupid either. You know, like, you're not gonna go jump off a bridge because you know what's gonna happen. Evaluate what those risks or evaluate what the outcome might be if you take this risk. Make sure you've thoroughly thought about it. What's the worst that could happen? Are you okay with that? Can you live with that? Because it could happen. That's what a risk is. And what's the best that could happen? Weigh it out. Take smart risk. And I say that both professionally and personally as well. Again, you're going to make mistakes. I'm going to continue to make tons of mistakes. But use them as an opportunity to learn and to grow. Set personal and professional values. We do this at Emerge all the time. And I put raise there because those are the values of Emerge Americas. And that's to be resilient, to be accountable, to be impactful, to be soulful. And people say, soulful? A tech company? Really? When there's no real human interaction? And I say, exactly. That's why we need to differentiate ourselves. We need to have a soul. If Emerge Americas didn't have a soul, we wouldn't succeed. And I want everyone in our team to feel that. There's a purpose behind what we're doing. And excellence. Always strive for excellence. You don't have to be, you know, the best of the best in everything you do, but at least strive to be the best. Don't settle for mediocre. And go all in. I happen to love poker. I happen to love Texas Hold'em. I'm not advocating gambling, okay, at all. But yeah, go all in. Similar to being passionate. We knew building this that we had to put everything we had into it in order for it to succeed. And this is one of my favorite ones, the next one. This one my father taught me from when I was, little girl running around his office. Keep your word. Doesn't matter what you sign on a contract. Doesn't matter. What you said means everything. People will trust you. You will build a great reputation. And there's nothing worse than a liar. And again, some people will fall back on, I signed this contract. Oh, but you told me that. Follow through on your word. And surround yourself with amazing people. I mean, I know that sounds probably something you've heard a million times. But I feel that way about my family. I feel that way about my team, who's pictured there behind you. It's a small team of us putting on a gigantic effort. And I want them all to be passionate about it. So surround yourself by amazing people, because the people who are crazy enough to think they could change the world are the ones who do. That's my favorite quote. I'm going to leave you with a recommendation of a book that's called Crazy is a Compliment by Linda Rottenberg. She's the co-founder and CEO of Endeavor. If you haven't heard of Linda or Endeavor, I would look up the organization, but they help high impact entrepreneurs all over the world. She tells incredible stories. It's inspirational. And that's my crazy crew of kids and nieces and nephews. And crazy might define our family, might define us. And I'm completely okay with that because of what Steve Jobs said. People who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. And I'm going to end by inviting all of you to Emerge Americas on March 30th and 31st of 2020. And thank you again for having me here today. I think we have a little time for Q&A if anyone has any questions by any chance. Sure, go ahead.
Hello, Melissa. My name is Polo Coronado.
Hi, I'm with Europe, from Europe.
South Florida. Yes, thank you. So we work with Opportunity Youth, and these guys are so talented. Mm-hmm. What would be your recommendation in terms of, they are 18 to 24, they are studying hard, working hard. What would be your recommendation in terms of where they should be investing their time in education, which languages, certifications, soft skills? Should they be studying to get ready for all those amazing jobs of the future?
It's a great question. I think it really depends on what they're interested in. The great news is that all these amazing institutions now have so many different programs within different verticals of technology, within cybersecurity. So it really is going to depend on what their interest is. But I think the good news is that now, say, especially within the last 5 to 10 years, there's so many new programs, and there's certifications that you could get in a much shorter time period. So the future of learning has really changed. And there's so many more opportunities for students to get certifications and to be able to code. We have incredible coding schools also in Miami now. And my other piece of advice to them would be to, you know, absorb as much information as possible. Read, listen to podcasts. If I could recommend two podcasts, one is How I Built This by Guy Raz. Is incredible. I've learned a lot of incredible entrepreneurial stories from him, from the people he's interviewed. And Masters of Scale by Reid Hoffman, who's the founder of LinkedIn. Amazing, amazing stories that will blow your mind and will inspire you throughout your journey also.
Hey, Melissa.
Hi.
Gino Jaramillo, I'm a professor here in the College of Engineering.
Hi, Gino.
Hey. Your story is so amazing, and you look so glamorous. You made it look so easy. Like you
should have seen me at 6 o'clock this morning with the 5 kids getting ready for school.
Yeah, you looked like you had an easy time. You know, the daughter of the founder, all these wonderful opportunities you had. But what was your biggest struggle? What was the one thing that made you feel like you had to quit and you didn't?
Great question. And so I think, going back to your first point of, you know, I look put together and stuff, and I think, you know, makeup and outfits do wonders. And back to the stereotype of being, you know, the boss's daughter, but I worked my butt off. I also absorbed everything he was doing from a very young age. And it doesn't have to be your father. It could be any mentor. Say, try to absorb an incredible person or influence that you have in your life. And, you know, what was my biggest struggle? I'd say I was pregnant with my 5th child, which was a very complicated pregnancy, to say the least. Had to be treated in CHOP in Philadelphia. And her, again, you make plans and God laughs. Her due date was the same exact date of Emerge America's first day, 2016. And I was so stressed about this. Struggled both because of the pregnancy and then professionally, how was I going to get this done? She came 2 weeks early. I think she knew I was talking to her. You cannot be born on Emerge, like, you know. And that's, I think, part of your, you know, of course, I was excited to have her and have her be healthy. And at the same time, Emerge is another baby for me. I knew it had to be successful. I had her 2 weeks before, C-section, and was out at Emerge the next week already building it out. And it was a struggle for me. I think it was probably the biggest struggle in my personal life for those few months. But it also made me realize, okay, I'm really resilient. Like, if I could get through a C-section, a complicated pregnancy, and put on at the time it was like 15,000 people gathering, I think I could. So you gotta talk yourself through those struggles.
Hi, Melissa, my name is Alberto. I'm a student here at FIU. And my question is that I've been recently listening to conferences that talk about, like, as Hispanics, of how by genetics we have a poor mentality, like due to a historical event, but we have a poor mentality, meaning that we see always money as bad or successful as something very hard, or always when we see someone successful, we say like, oh, this person did something wrong for it, or is dealing with drug dealers, or is with gangsters, like whatever, something like that. And I'm wondering, like, what can be like some of the key habits that you can develop to get rid of this poor mentality and go to like a rich mentality?
Good question, but I would say I would challenge that and say maybe they're reading the wrong information, because you're in a city that was built by immigrants. There's, you know, the hard work is in Hispanics' blood. Yes. And so I think if they nurture that, they're going to be successful. If they're going to give themselves negative thoughts and, you know, stick to their own story that they're creating or maybe a few bad influences, then that's the path they're going to take. But if they really want to look for the right information, they don't have to look very far at the immigrants and Hispanic community right around them.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Hi. My name is Daniela. Thank you so much for being so candid in your story. I'm an FIU proud alum, and I'm a founder of, thank you, and I'm a founder of an e-commerce store. My question to you is, I work a lot with the startup FIU, the community here in Miami, around startups, but I see a huge issue with this whole brain drain and not the best paying jobs. But what I've noticed is a lot of leaders in tech companies, maybe there's a senior person that leaves that's making 150, and then they give that job to three people at 45K. And I just wanted to know, like, what are the types of conversation you being a leader in, obviously with eMERGE and getting that ecosystem to think better long-term, the investment in our tech talent, what are the conversations we're having around that space? And maybe who's someone that we can look for as an example of best practices?
Yeah, great question. And the landscape of our ecosystem has dramatically changed over the last few years. And I'm not standing here saying that we're already in this like thriving, burgeoning tech hub with all these incredible high-paying technology jobs, because I would be lying if I said that. But I will sit here telling you that the foundation is strong, really strong. We have all the ingredients in South Florida to create this thriving tech hub. And we have tons of opportunity as well. It's a matter of seizing those opportunities, but it takes time. It takes time for, it's the chicken or the egg. Right now we have incredible startup activity, high quality startups. We have a great angel investor network. We need more VCs, which is why we partner with FIU to showcase the venture activity in Florida, because we want to attract more LPs, more VCs, more venture activity. Because if they're investing in these startups and in ideas like yours, and you succeed, it creates a whole snowball effect. So it's just a matter of time. There's, if you think of Uber, Facebook, Spotify, and the list goes on and on of technology companies, they weren't even here 6 years ago. They're all here now. No, are their headquarters here? No. We came close with Amazon. And I have to tell you, we have to be proud of that. Miami came in the top 20 cities for potential Amazon headquarters. Miami 10 years ago wouldn't even have been on the radar for Amazon. So that tells you that we have the ingredients, but it's going to take a little time.
How are you?
Good.
My name is Jenny. I'm a student here, communication major. My question was mostly, since eMERGE is a hub for like all technologies, is there one for potential, like myself who wish to go to the filmmaking industry? Is there like technologies like that for us where we can like develop our craft and I guess like before we enter the field we want to enter in, like things I can do for like using eMERGE to go into the field I want to go in?
Great question. So our focus has not been in film and media and entertainment yet. We have focused a lot on education, on cybersecurity, on health tech, on fintech. But I will say, if I was your age and a student, whether I was in high school or college, I wish I had an eMERGE to attend, no matter what industry I was in. Because technology that they're talking about affects all industries. So you're gonna be able to learn and connect and meet with different people that are within your industry as well. But do we have a specific focus on film right now? No. But I would still encourage you, because you're gonna be around a lot of like-minded folks and get a lot of ideas and inspiration from the people you meet.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, thank you. Oh yeah, you're gonna ask a question, I'm scared.
You're not getting off the hook here. Okay, so there's a two-part question. Knowing what you know now about what you're doing, If you had to redo your education pathway, what would you do differently? That's one. And two, if you had the opportunity to turn this place upside down and restructure the learning environment, what would be your top three priorities?
Okay, wow, great question. Okay, so I do think about the first question a lot, and I would have done a couple things differently. And the first part you might not want to hear, but it's that I wish I would have gone further away. I feel like for myself, having been born and raised in Miami, I would have liked to have gone further experience-wise and come back to this amazing community and city. But secondly, I definitely would not have majored in real estate and urban analysis. I mean, I did that because, again, because of the story I told. But if I could go back, definitely business. I think business has also changed a lot. I think you could be taught a lot within entrepreneurship. So I probably would have gone towards something more entrepreneurial focused. I would have learned to code. I wish I would have done that. I still want to do that now. Learn another language, and I'm not talking Spanish or English. I'm talking like a coding language. I think it's a huge advantage. And nowadays, you could take courses within your university or different coding academies. So I would have done that as well. And to your second question, I think you're doing a lot of it already. I think with the programs I mentioned earlier, I think what I would love to see, I think in any university, is more connection between all of those. That everyone is sort of working together within that innovative umbrella and knowing what each other are doing. And I see it, I mean, I see it in, I'm not talking specifically about FIU, but in other universities where all of these different innovative verticals, if you will, within a university are very separated. They don't talk to each other. There isn't this like flow of information within that space. So I would almost like make them talk to each other, put them all together in the same building, in the same space, and just also making sure that the messaging to all your students is there, that you have this accessible to them. That would be my... That's it. Thank you, Nathan.
Thank you, Melissa. Really, really insightful. I have one last question for you as well. What did you learn about leading others that you learned along the way? Like maybe that you didn't know 20 years ago, 15 years ago.
Yeah. Oops, I took my mic off, but I'm going to answer that here. So I would say that, I think it's all tied into me. I would say that I'm still learning about leadership. I think every day with my team, I learn more about leadership. But I think if I could pick one thing, it's if you're leading people and if you have a team of folks, do not be a micromanager. I think I did that a lot early on. I'm very OCD in a way, type A. And I know that if I'm going to do it, it'll happen this way, but you have to realize that you have to give folks in your team ownership. They have to make mistakes also. And it also builds a relationship with them that allows them to bring ideas to you, many of which are incredible ideas. And if you're constantly micromanaging, which I did do, you don't allow that kind of space to foster. So I would say allow your team to make mistakes. And in my team, it's a very horizontal team. We all wear multiple hats, and we all work together as a team. I would say that's probably the best piece of advice.
Melissa, thank you so much for being here. Really appreciate it. Thank you all for being here. We hope you have enjoyed and gotten some insights I think there's so many nuggets, I think, for everyone in different aspects. So thank you for sharing your time with us. Thank you for being here. As many of you know, and some of you, maybe this is your first leadership lecture that you've attended, we host this fantastic series, and we're going to be every year, and we've been starting, we'll be starting it up again in January. We have a great lineup coming up, so please be on the lookout for that. Thank you for your time. There will be a brief reception afterwards, and enjoy yourself. Thanks again for coming.